you implied a connection between the speakers and the Liberal group and what we stand for. What we stand for is to have an invitation for a debate about this very important, very complex, very thought-provoking topic. But we, of course, speak on our own behalf, and so do the speakers. And I think this is really important also in terms of this debate, really, because what too often happens is that the words or the expressions of one individual are connected or implied to be applicable for the entire group, or an alleged group of people, rather. And so I would just like to share my thoughts, and I think a thought that fits very well with liberal thinking is that individuals should be held accountable for their own expressions, that we should be very, very careful with group thinking in the context of this freedom of expression debate. I do believe that fighting discrimination is very, very important, but it all depends on by which measures. So, for example, let's say, you know, unequal pay for equal job. That's discrimination based on, could be on gender, which we see very frequently in Europe, or it's unequal treatment. Those are objective or measurable standards. And I think that the challenge with being offended, feeling offended, or offending as such is that it's so incredibly subjective, because what is an offense to one person could be a compliment to another, and that's not even exaggerated. So this is a very murky territory, and I believe it was either Julian or someone else who in the introduction raised the issue that out of fear to be called a racist or discriminating, there can already be a hesitance to express. And laws in this respect are only the last resort. They are, of course, fundamental because they shape the frame, but I do think as politicians and as opinion makers and as citizens, we have a huge responsibility to give space to as open a debate and to make people capable and resilient to take part in a critical but open debate, because the law should really only be the last resort. And until that, I think we should create as much space as possible to address differences, senses of humor, pieces of art, pieces of opinion, information, what have you, without having to go to a court. But if we do, it needs to be objectively measurable points. And indeed, discrimination needs to be fought based on those, but not based on some sort of subjective conception of what, you know, what words or other expressions should be interpreted as. I think it is, you know, one of those far borders of freedom of expression, and it's actually up to a judge, I think, to decide on a case-by-case basis, because it will often not be one person who stands up and calls for genocide, but there's usually apparatus in place of communications, of incitement, that's not just one individual saying something, but it's a whole mechanism that touches upon a whole number of other issues of indoctrination or influencing large numbers of people. At least as important is to make a resilient society where people don't blindly follow any kind of incitement to do whatever, because I think that's the real risk. How come, or you know, how is it possible that people even feel interested in blindly following, or not blindly, but at least following such extreme calls for violence? So I think that that is at least as important, and also the slippery slope leading up to that. But when it comes to prohibiting any kind of speech, I often think about the label that exists in the United States on records, on CDs, when they were still more in fashion than they are today with online music, but where it said, you know, parental guidance advised explicit language on this CD. I don't think there could have been a better marketing tool for CDs, because how cool is it to have, you know, vulgar language on your CD? So I think sometimes banning something actually makes it much bigger than it would be if it would have just found its proportionate place in a resilient society in an open debate.